purpose of this meeting tonight is to elect, according to the terms of our charter, elect a school committee member for Ward 6. And there's a vacancy, and I think we'll identify the candidates afterwards after we do the roll. But first I want to say that I'm going to be presumptuous here and speak for everyone that we're extremely grateful for anyone who's prepared to step up and commit themselves to this level of public service. Not because we did, and we're saying welcome to the club. In fact, this is actually I'm really grateful for someone who appreciates the value of this level of participation in civic government. And the school committee exists because they preside over the most significant portion of the budget in the city. It's so significant that there's a separate body of representation. So this is the responsibility that you're stepping up for, and we're all very appreciative. With that, blah, 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 I'm going to ask the clerk to call the roll, please.
Mr. Dennis Bidwell?
Here.
Ms. Maureen Kearney?
Present.
Mr. Goldwife?
Here.
Ms. Elizabeth Klein?
Here.
Ms. Marianne LaBarge? Mr. David Murphy?
Here.
Mr. Jamie Hamp?
Here.
Mr. Ryan O'Donnell?
Here.
Ms. Gina Louise Chiaro?
Here.
Ms. Molly Burnham?
Present.
Ms. Brendan Kuzanski?
Present.
Ms. Laura Fallon?
Present.
Ms. Ann Hennessy?
Present.
Mr. John Meyer? Mr. Howard Moore?
Here.
Mayor David Narquith? Mr. Nat Reed?
Present.
And Mr. Ezra.
Okay, well, we certainly have a quorum. The mayor is on his way. He left Springfield about 10 minutes ago, so we'll see if he gets to make it. Let me break it down how this is going to go. We've done this a few times in the past, but in this instance, what we're going to do is we'll allow people interested in the position to step up, make their presentation. Those of you who have forwarded documents, they've been shared with all the members, all the electors here. At that point, there'll be an opportunity for questions if any of the electors have questions. And then the vote. And it's a simple majority will decide. The vote will be, it's a roll call vote. And once a school committee member has been selected, they will be sworn in by the city clerk. Wendy Ma is over there. We'll swear you in immediately, and then you're in the hot seat. You're starting work at 7 o'clock when the school committee meeting officially starts. So with that, I mean, can people interested in the position please raise their hand so I can identify your name? All right. Tom Davidson, Lonnie Call. All right. Lonnie, you're sitting up first.
Bill, can I?
Yes. Oh, I'm sorry. Councilor Scherer.
Yeah, I just have a quick disclosure. Actually, I wasn't looking. So I don't know Mr. Kaufman personally, but his wife is my daughter's teacher, so I'm just disclosing that. But actually, I wasn't looking, so I don't even know which one of you is Mr. Kaufman. Hi. Nice to meet you. That's just my disclosure about that.
Okay. Councilor Scherer is abiding by Massachusetts open meeting law and ethics law by identifying a possible conflict, although that is not a conflict that is fiduciary in any way. So there we go. Lonnie, would you like to step up first?
Sure. Everyone know what your expectations are in terms of time?
All we need to do is end this by 7 o'clock so that whoever gets chosen.
Although our agenda does say 3 minutes.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, I didn't.
It also says alphabetical.
We'll give you some room there. There are only two candidates, so we'll give you some room.
Okay, and I don't have really that much that I prepared or want to say. I'll just wing it for the most part. Thank you very much. I didn't know my wife, too, is your son or daughter's teacher.
I got it.
My wife is a teacher at Bridge Street. I didn't know whether that actually allowed me to be or to serve as a member of the school committee. I emailed Councilor Dwight, and he affirmed that I am. So if I am fortunate enough to be elected, I think that I'll need to have some guidance on what particular issues I may or may not need to recuse myself from. I know there's a pretty strong Massachusetts State Ethics Commission. Maybe I would need to talk to them. But I'm happy I have the opportunity, and I'm happy to certainly follow whatever rules I need to ensure that none of my votes are skewed in any way from my own personal interests. If you all did receive, I think I wrote a cover letter and I wrote a resume, and I just wanted to maybe highlight some of the aspects that I wanted to bring to your attention that, if you haven't had a chance to read it or just hear me say it, is a little bit different than reading it on paper, I'm sure. So let me begin in terms of why I think I'm qualified to be a member of the Ward 6 School Committee, or to serve the school committee as a member, as a representative of Ward 6, I mean to say. I've worked for 25 plus years in public education. I grew up in New York. I attended public schools. I went to State University in New York. I then majored in education, teacher education. I wanted to be a social studies teacher. I quickly realized that what I really wanted to do was work with kids individually. So as much as I like teaching, I quickly decided to get my master's degree in school counseling because that would allow me to work more one-on-one, or so I thought at that point. In fact, I think I wanted to initially be a school psychologist, and I foolishly thought that that would actually allow me to work with kids, and it seemed like that school psychology at that point, it may or may not be the same, was a lot about psychometric testing and not doing as much one-on-one sort of guidance. So while I was in the program, I decided to major in counselor education, and I worked at the elementary school level, middle school level, and high school level with my practicums. After I graduated, I had an opportunity to, I had a job offer at a middle school to be a guidance counselor. It was the middle school I did my internship with. But I also had an opportunity to work as an itinerant high school counselor in San Diego, working across schools and helping young adults with disabilities help with their transition to life after high school. And I did that for 7 or 8 years, and it was an incredible mind-opening opportunity for me to see. First of all, I had volunteered. My passion is to work with kids that are underserved. And so San Diego had 17 high schools, and I wanted to work with the schools that were most challenged. And at that point, and I do think things have changed, but at that point, it was a really segregated school system. You had rich, affluent schools in the northern parts, La Jolla and such, Miramar. And you had the city of San Diego and Southeast San Diego, which was majority low income, very low educated, broken families, gang problems, drug problems, high dropout problems, a lot of the situations in LA that were creeping down to San Diego, drive-by shootings. It was tough. It was really tough. But I was working with kids with special needs, but that wasn't their special need. I mean, I was trying to help them get employment and transition to life after high school. Their biggest challenge was poverty. And I did an awful lot of work with families, with kids, and I saw the difference that a mentor, I consider myself a mentor or a counselor in individual kids' lives, and that kind of thrust me in my career to continue to work in public education. I expanded my reach to not work as much individually with kids, but always focus on doing whatever we could to ensure that our public education systems are providing high-quality services for all kids. So I've worked, like I said, as a teacher, as a counselor. I moved on and became like a technical assistance provider in Vermont and Massachusetts. We moved back east. And then for the last 17 years ago, I switched to University of Massachusetts, majority of this time at the UMass Donahue Institute, where I was applied social science and program evaluation specialist. That was strictly in the world of K-12, or pre-K-12, I should say, and brought me into an abundance of school districts, schools, working on trying to solve challenges, collecting data, understanding issues, working with a client to really help them understand whether what they were doing was making a difference, whether the data supports whether they're making a difference, and giving them information to change or to modify their approach if necessary in order to meet the outcomes. The outcomes were always great. The method to getting there sometimes needed some assistance, and I just love working in partnership with a bunch of folks in order to do that. And I think that my research and evaluation background hopefully will be a complement to the school committee. I've also been very, very involved with our own district. Started formally as a member of the Ryan Road Elementary School Council for 3 years, was elected the co-chair along with Mr. Crowther. And then I took a year off, and then I came back with Mr. Petrie, became the elementary school counselor, and again I was elected co-chair. And then as my kids got older, I had two kids go through the school system. I worked with the Northampton High School Counselor with Principal Singer. Again, you really learn the ins and outs of a school system when you're that entrenched, probably not as entrenched as being a school committee member, but really opened my eyes again to what was happening, the policy issues, some of the issues that the kids brought to the table, the students, and it was a great, great opportunity for me. I will admit that during that time, I was constantly interested in running for school committee, but there was two things that stopped me. One is that I was afraid I didn't have the time. Now that my kids are out of the house, I have the time all of a sudden. Like I tell my friends about shows on Netflix, and they say, when do you have time to watch these shows? It's like, in the evening, what do you mean? And it's like, maybe I need to find some other stuff to do in the evening. But it really was like, hey, I got some more time now. Now's the time to do it. The other thing is that Lisa Minnick, I was blessed to have her as my school committee member for probably 20 years, if not more. And I didn't want to challenge her. I got along with her real well. I would talk to her very often. We didn't always agree, but she was so hardworking. She was so fundamentally sound about historical issues and what needed to happen that I felt like my role would be as a member, as a person in her district, to maybe call her, talk to her, share my views, but I never felt comfortable challenging her. I just, in fact, talked to her a couple of days ago to see if I was crazy or whether this is actually a good job for me, and I had her whole blessing to do this, along with many other people. So I'm happy again that I have support for this from the people I care about a lot. I will say that I do not have an issue, a personal agenda item or a specific issue. If I ever did, it was probably because of situations that my children had, and I think it helps me to now be a member of the committee now that my kids are no longer in school. I have a much clearer mind. I've been, like I said, to many, many other school systems and districts. So I'm not a specific issue. There's no single individual issue or agenda item that motivates me. I think rather I'm just committed to helping us do the best we can to spread, expand, and support those things that we're doing that are working well, and maybe think about alternatives for those aspects of those programs, issues, or conditions that people are working under that really need some adjustments. And finally, I'll say I used to watch school committee meetings a lot. That's what I used to do in the evening. And I know about, and as a resident, I know about all the budget issues. I know how much the budget has really torn down the school system in many ways. I'm incredibly thankful for the mayor and you guys and the great community support we have for people who advocate from the political perspective in Boston, as well as local education foundations and whatnot. It's an incredible community that we have to kind of try and bridge the gap between what we're getting from the state and other resources, federal government probably these days, and what we're doing locally. And I don't have a magic answer to that. I will support whatever avenues I can support. I want to get reengaged, and I'm looking forward to ways that we could maybe creatively solve situations so that we can continue to rebuild and continue the great things that we have going on currently.
Thank you. Questions of the candidate?
I'll just apologize that I arrived late. I just broke a few speed limits getting back from another meeting, but so I apologize for walking in.
Council Murphy.
I'll ask a question.
Sure, thank you.
If you're not successful this evening, would you consider running for the position in November?
I would talk to, what was your name? See how it's going, and I'd pay attention. I mean, I don't have like an ego. I need to be on the school committee. I mean, it's the same reason with Lisa. If somebody's here and doing a good job, unless I really, really missed it, I mean, right now I feel like it's the right time for me, and I'm excited to join, but if there's somebody else who's doing a fantastic job, I would probably talk to that person and just see how they feel about it and work it out. If they had opposing positions or opinions, I probably would be motivated to, but I don't see all that much in Northampton. Occasionally there's people that have really outrageous opinions, but I think that they're kind of, I find them to be an anomaly on the city council and the school committee. I don't know if you agree with me.
Thank you.
Yeah, sure.
Committee Member Fallon.
Despite the fact that you don't have kids in the schools anymore, would you still hope to go into the schools for, concerts, science fairs, go to sporting events, stuff like that?
Yeah, I still do that. I still do that. I mean, I work, I live on Cardinal Way. We have a lot of young kids on the block. We seem to have some stellar athletes, so it's easy. It's easy for me to think about going to the sporting events. It was one of my favorite things. My son played all three different sports. My daughter didn't, but she was involved in the arts and other things. Yeah. We're very involved. Like, bought tickets today for life in the 413. There's lots of things happening in Northampton. When we moved here from San Diego, we've never looked back. It's a wonderful community. I don't know if I'll be as involved. I don't know if that's an expectation of school committee members, but it sounds like you all are really busy with not only school committees, but subcommittees and advocating for funds and meeting with folks around the budget to better understand. And I don't know how many phone calls like you all get, but I would hope that I can make myself available to the community. I really, really don't have hard-wedded opinions. I value my opinions based on lots of feedback, and I take that in. I think I read a lot, and I try and establish my opinions based on what conversations I have with folks. So I hope I get that from my constituents, which may or may not. If going to these events opens up opportunities to do that, I'd be really motivated too. But if it takes time away, I might decide otherwise. Do you do that a lot?
I have 4 kids. I don't really have a choice.
So you have no time.
No time. No Netflix.
Councilor Klein.
Hi, I have a bit of a long lead into my question, so bear with me. Sure. So I looked at DESE, and I hope that I have these numbers right, but in 2017 at Northampton High School, I couldn't find the numbers for the elementary schools. 74% of the students are white, 26% are students of color, 94% of the teaching staff is white. So I have two questions that kind of stem from these statistics. So we know that studies show that kids need to feel part of the community that they come to every day to succeed. And other studies show that there's a great deal of unconscious bias amongst white white teachers. They're not included in conversation. Kids of color aren't included in conversations the same way that white Sure. kids are.
Yeah.
They're not asked questions to the same extent that the white kids are. So in a school system that serves predominantly white students, and that is staffed overwhelmingly by white teachers, how can we ensure that bias and racial discrimination aren't being played out towards students of color, potentially alienating them, putting them onto the school to prison pipeline kind of track? What are your ideas and thoughts about that? And then the other piece is, how can Northampton work to recruit and retain teachers of color,
right,
so that we can create a little bit of balance between the numbers of students of color and the teachers?
Yeah, I'll answer the second question first, if I can. I worked in the Amherst Regional Schools for a while. They're a very active community. They had hired a deputy commissioner, deputy superintendent for equity, and she had that exact job of trying to recruit, market, and make Amherst seem an attractive option for teachers of color. They devoted a lot of time and attention to it, and I don't know if they made any progress. And it struck me as, like, this is despite how you feel about Amherst overall, it's a fantastic school system. They had incredible things going on, and it seemed like they were paying pretty well. They had somebody spend time doing this. They had a whole community that was paying attention to it. And there was a stumbling block there. So I guess what I'm saying is, I don't know what the answer is, but I know it's a problem, and I'm wholeheartedly supportive of things that we can do to kind of rectify that. But I'd be lying if I said I know what we can do, because some of the obvious things just didn't seem to work out. I would probably, if we were working on that, I would look at other districts that have tried to change that situation and find out what didn't, or more so didn't work, so we wouldn't replicate that. In terms of what we can do, you know, I see, in terms of the students themselves, I see small things. I mean, I watch the school committee. I watch Dr. Provost talk about what his feeling was about inclusion and the reasons behind elementary school inclusion, and the fact that many kids that were being discluded from regular education programs were kids of color. And that was a tremendous selling point for me. Things like that go a long way, that maybe that's not the main reason for doing stuff, but it's a real push in that direction. I think we live in a community in Northampton that really embraces equity and social justice. I know I do. And when somebody has a good ideas and can bring it to the table and have a good, wholesome discussion about it, I think that we'll find a lot of support. I can tell you that I will almost always support that endeavors such as that, depending on what the downside is, depending if anybody else is hurt in the process, because I think some of these things are really complex. But we can do small things to get there. we need people like you to raise the issue when we talk about, hey, we're working on this, here's the percent this year, here's the percent last year, here's the percent 2 years ago. There's either an upswing or a downswing, or it's remaining the same. It's important to raise those issues, but it's something that we share. The facts, the data is consistent with many, many school districts, but we live in a community, I think, that really cares a lot about it. And I could look around the school committee and basically make the same argument that we are just not very well represented in cases like that. So we have an uphill battle as a community, I think, but we have a lot of support in doing so. That was a long answer to your long question, but I'd love to talk to you more about it, however this turns out. Yeah.
Any other questions? Councilor Shara, and then
Sort of piggybacking on something that you just mentioned, what are your feelings on the new model that the elementary schools are moving to?
My feelings on it. I've talked to so many people about it. It's interesting. I felt pretty strongly that it was the right way to go. I also felt, and no disrespect, I also felt like that it needed more planning, and I'm afraid that it might be implemented too soon. I happened to go to a conference a week ago, the New England Secondary School Conference. It was in Hartford. There was 1,200 people there, and I went to a breakout session that just had to do with this co-teaching model in a school in Maine, and they said it took them 8 years to finally get to where they needed to be. And I asked them a lot of questions, probing, because I knew that I had a possibility of being on the committee, and they said it felt like, you know, if you alienate teachers right off the bat, it might be problematic. Since then, I've been trying to pay attention to it. I know there's been some PD. I know that this is something that you all recognize. I totally embrace the idea that we can't keep putting things off, but I feel like a little bit more time would have been good, but I love the idea. I absolutely love the idea, and I think that we're not innovative. This is what many school districts are doing already. This is what many schools are doing in Vermont. We're a little bit behind the times, and I think there's an awful lot we could learn from other districts and other schools how they've gone about doing this. But my main reservation is whether it's being done in such a way. I have a great amount of respect for teachers, and many of them are feeling like this is happening too quick, and I think that's an important consideration. I don't always feel like that's an important consideration, but in this case, I feel some compassion for the people that have talked to me, where they're coming from.
Committee Member Reed.
Hi. I was wondering, after funding, what's the biggest challenge that you see in the Northampton Public Schools and what you would do to work on that?
Other than the budget?
Yes.
It's so hard to separate those two. You know, there's so many aspects that are occurring. But I think overall, I mean, well-working suburban schools are hard to really drive systemic change. I've worked in places that are undergoing whole school, system-wide school change for everybody's benefit, and often it's coined about helping kids get the skills and knowledge they need for today and the future economy. And that's kind of like jargon-ish kind of stuff that tends to materialize, but I do think that the way we're teaching kids and the way that kids are learning is somewhat restricted to classroom activities, despite great field trips and some community-based learning and some apprenticeships and some volunteer opportunities. I still think we're fundamentally in a situation that would benefit from some change, and I would say probably significant change 10 or 20 years down the road, but I think we need to begin to build that now. And I think there'll be a lot of support, and I can talk to you more about models that I'm referring to, but it's just so hard. It's just so hard to change when there's no money to change, sorry. And it's hard to get a willingness when it means more stuff. And so unless there's a whole school and a whole community sort of support to really come up with a plan that's going to take some facets away and replace it with other stuff, it's really, really hard to ask teachers to do anything more than they're currently doing. It's really overwhelming to be a teacher. So I'm cognizant of that, but I'm also cognizant that we might be falling behind what these kids are going to need if we don't change something soon, even though it's a long-lasting change. Does that make sense?
Yeah, very much so.
Anyone else? Councilor
Dunn. Thank you for your interest and all your volunteerism so far. Yeah. I did want to ask a very kind of open-ended question. You can interpret it however you wish, but To you, what is the purpose of public education?
This is like asking Ted Kennedy why he wants to be president, right? Wow. I mean, I think to me, public education is the great equalizer. It's the great opportunity for us, for young people, to all, if it works well, to all start off on the right foot and be prepared for success after school. I mean, after school, whether it's college, careers, life, lifelong learning, what have you. It's the one of the greatest things in this country. It's a law. I mean, some states it's 18. Here at Massachusetts, I think it's still 16. We have people fighting, putting their lives at risk to come to this country in order to go to school. It's an amazing thing. And I worked in places like Springfield and Boston and Worcester, where you have a lot of immigrants, and they don't speak the language, they don't have money. They went through such turmoil to get to this country just to send their kids to school. And it's an incredible thing to watch. At the same time, you're watching some kids that don't care about school and they're lost, and you feel like, what are we doing wrong? Like it's the most beautiful thing that this country can offer, and many other countries, I know. But at the same time, I'm getting ahead of myself. It's the opportunity to really put people in the driver's seat to equalize the path forward. And I'm a big fan of starting school earlier, in preschool, and if parents want that opportunity, and to move forward and beyond high school. So,
thank you very much.
You're welcome. Yeah.
Anyone else? Listen, anybody?
Mr. Kaufman, thank you.
My 3 minutes are up.
just tick over. Don't worry about it. It was, yeah, as I said, we're giving some latitude here with only two right. candidates. But
thank you for the opportunity. Thank you all for your service.
Thank you.
See you again.
Thank you. Mr. Davison, and start with a little bit of an advantage because you got a sense of what the questions are going to be. That's right.
Thank you. My name is Tom Davidson. I'm resident of Ward 6. Decided to throw my hat in the ring when I heard there was an opening. So I've been a Ward 6 resident for about 15, 16 years now. I've been city resident for about 20 years. I'm also a parent of Ryan Road student now and a Northampton High School freshman. So I've been a parent of the Northampton School District now and going on 11 years. So I feel like I've been in the schools, in the district, all the way through so far. I'm also a teacher. I teach high school science at West Springfield High School. I've been a teacher for 11 years. I started in Amherst and now I'm down at West Springfield High School. So I really think that I have a good perspective on what it would be to be on the other side of these desks. From the trenches as a teacher, what the requirements are and what the pressures are from a teacher point of view, and from a parent at multiple levels of kids with different things going on. What does that look like? What does the district need to be successful as a parent and as a student from that perspective? I, as well, at Ryan Road, was on school council there for 3 years, first under Principal Riddle and then with Principal Madden. So I saw the transition there of leadership from one really good principal to another, and saw Principal Madden take over, and that's been really nice, and it's a really good school. Ward 6 is a really interesting ward to have. It's sort of split between two schools. We're over in one piece of the ward that was technically a Bridge Street school street in the district, but we choiced into Ryan Road because my daughter had a peer group that we wanted to stay with, and we were able to use school choice to go to Ryan Road and keep her in that peer group, and it was a terrific choice. That's been a great community school there to be a part of, which I really appreciate. It's sort of right in the middle of things, and it's a big school with a lot of, it's was in the paper about the changes recently, having all the special ed there, having the single floor, having that extra burden. So that's been interesting to watch how they've managed that. As a teacher in the classroom, I know how the budgets go, and I know how that feels on the other side of the desk, and I know how that has felt when I was in Amherst, and we would have faculty meetings, and in that district, it would start in October, where the principal would say, it's going to be bad, be ready, it's going to be bad. So we would already be knowing it was bad until May, and it was bad. So I know how that kind of react, what you have to do on the other side. Science is my background. I'm a biology and earth science teacher. I studied geology at UMass and came in through that to teaching. And I've also, one of the things that I found my way into is I am on the assessment development committee for the biology MCAS test for the high school. So I sort of understand what the testing side of students' life is, because we have to, as a school district, be ready to prepare the kids for that dreaded MCAS. And I don't like to harp on testing as a thing, because it's too much of a hoop to jump through. But I like to know, I'm part of it because it helps me to know what students have to be prepared for, and are we making them ready for it, and are they going to be ready for it. Everything changed at the state level recently, standards for science, and that's trickled down, and it's not going to be in a good position to keep up with that as everything kind of changed in the science requirements world, and recently in English and math, they changed the standards. So as a teacher, I'm aware of a lot of those sides of things. I think our district is really, as Councilor Klein mentioned, our district is really very strangely diverse or undiverse in ways. And that's something that needs to be, we need to be aware of as a community and as a district. And I think where I work at West Springfield, we have 86 different languages in 33 different countries in our high school alone. So we're wrestling with a town that has a very traditional base and is a very diverse school. And I've seen that have to be worked out on the ground, and what does that mean for classes and for teachers and for students to learn to get along with other people, other cultures, other places, and to be diverse and inclusive is a tricky balance to find. I think this city has a lot of people who have really stepped up over the years as budgets change, as things have become difficult. We have people in the city who really stand up and work to help the schools almost all the time for what, as things come up, the schools are something that is always being fought for by various groups, which is nice to see, and I'm glad to step up and try to do that as a person in the community. Let's see. One thing I think we can think about is how do we, if the budget is lean, if the district is not going to get the golden budget every year, well, how can we do that? How can we always act with this knife over our head, like another year, another budget, it's going to be bad, it's going to be the don't get what you want budget. Thinking about new partnerships, where can you can't cut something else and get something. You know, we can't put the dump truck on the auction block to get the teacher, the paraprofessional in the classroom. So what do we have to do differently? We have to think about one thing that we do in my district down in West Springfield is we have college partnerships with places like Springfield Technical Community College and HCC, where students are using programs there. I know that at the high school they are taking classes at places like Smith and GCC, but we're also using grant-funded programs to let students learn early pathway to career programs in the high school with STIC, going back and forth. So maybe there's places where we can develop partnerships with other institutions beyond our little town, beyond just going back to Smith or staying in town, looking at a bigger community to think about, think from. I've been in a lot of schools just as a part of being a high school teacher, touring around, visiting things as I was learning to be a teacher. I don't think I've been in that many, but I've certainly visited a few, and I've talked to people in other districts. And it's true, we have a lot to cover, and being on the committee is a big part of that. And I think being a parent and being a teacher, I think I would like to try to do that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Questions? Council LaBarge, and we should note the Council LaBarge is from Ward 6.
But I do have some questions. Bryan Road School is the elementary school that most Ward 6 families are assigned to, and where most Ward 6 families send their children.
How would you advocate for Bryan Road School especially in the light of other schools having more success and ability to raise money with their PTOs to supplement the school budget? Could you answer that?
I think that our PTOs are a very strong part of our district. I'm really impressed with our PTOs. I'm frequently hearing almost weekly and more than weekly at times from the high school PTO now that my daughter is at the high school. And I see quite regularly the material from the Ryan Road PTO. We have very strong parent PTO involvement at all levels in this community, at the high school, middle school, and these elementary schools. We need to keep them involved, looking for new resources, looking for these partnerships, reaching out to our business community to bring in things. We just are finishing in the middle of a Ryan Road calendar raffle. So certainly those are things where businesses are helping us and helping our schools and community. I think that's a good way to keep that going, is to keep that in the local and bring in a lot of the business partnerships that we've continued to have.
Thank you. Also, my second question, what is your position on the gun range being used during the day or after school hours when many children are using the playground? And I had great concerns about that because I had so many phone calls between across the street on Ward 7 and Ward 6 about what was occurring there during school hours. So I'd like your position on that.
I'm familiar with the gun range. Usually you can tell you're not familiar with the gun range. It's over on Ryan Road across from R.K. Finn Ryan Road School. And if you're not sure what time it is, it's 3:01 when you hear the guns go off every day. And I know that from picking up my kids for years. The gun range, as I understand it, it knows when it's 3 o'clock and it starts sounding like a gun range across the street from an elementary school. I have never heard it during the school day on the visits I've made there during school days. So I don't know that they're doing it during the school day. I can't really speak to that, but I know that they are very promptly doing it after school is. And it's not every day after school. And
we had a problem last year where training had to occur. Their whole schedule at the police department, the range would not allow them to continue on with what they were doing. So I worked with Sarah Maiden very, very closely in the police department during the day. And a lot of parents were very concerned of that occurring. So we worked out to the best that we could so that the noise factor of it would not affect these children. So, but how do you feel about that?
Well, it's my understanding that the police, and I did a Cub Scout tour of the station, there is a range in the station, and I think I saw in the paper.
Opening soon.
So
that as an issue actually is no longer an issue. So.
I'm unclear as to what you're speaking of. Can you clarify? I'm not following.
The police department the police department needs to qualify every year for gun usage. And the only range that was accessible to them at the time was the one across from Ryan Road School, and unfortunately, those.
My backyard.
There you go. There is now the funding available and starting to develop a firing range in the new police station. Mm-hmm. So they will no longer need and plus, it also precluded, it wasn't their advantage, it precluded winters in line. So, In keeping with the questions, the theme of the questions, I think if we ask more generic questions and less granular ones on the issues, in this case, I think Mr. Davidson has shared his opinion on that. Do you have other questions relative to his candidacy?
I think I'm okay right now.
Okay. Anyone else? Any other questions? Councilor Shera, Councilor O'Donnell, and Councilor Klein. And then Mr. Reed.
I'll just ask the same question, which is what are your feelings on the new model that's going to be implemented at the elementary schools?
Thank you. The new model, I did read up on it. I was at the last meeting of the school committee to hear a little bit about it. And where I teach, we have co-teaching. I'm in a high school, so I'm not at the elementary level, but I have been a co-teacher. And I understand that a co-teacher is a really positive thing because we have two adults who are full teacher. We have the support of each other in the classroom. And when trained well and given the time to work together as adult teacher people and working, like, work on our planning and work on our lessons, it works really well. And it gives the kids a lot of support, because while one person could be giving some new information, presenting a new activity, the other teacher is able to directly work with students. Or you can split the class up. We would do that sometimes and have two classes at a time and then switch back and forth. So it really did provide two teachers for, not for the price of one, but two teachers for the in the place of one. And it really can work very well. And I think that at the elementary school level, those classes are so busy and dynamic that it can create that same kind of activity engagement for a lot of those kids. And a lot of it will be training, and a lot of it will be a change for some of these schools. So how it does and how I feel is, do we have the PD in place, the professional development, really help hit this thing running in September or whenever it's got to get going, so that the teachers feel supported in this model? If we can get those teachers supported and give them some time to work together and get to know each other and know what their roles are going to be, then they'll be successful. It'll be a really nice model. If we're a little shaky on our PD, that might be a little bit dicey.
Council O'Donnell, Council Klein, and then Committee Member Reed.
Mr. Davidson, I'd like to ask you the same very general question I asked last time. Could you just describe what you believe the purpose of public education is?
Thank you. I think public education provides a great opening step for everybody. It puts everybody on the same page. It means that your whole society, your whole, if we just took Northampton by itself and put it on the moon, our whole Northampton would be able to read, able to write, able to understand a little bit of math, even if we just got through the third grade level like my grandmother. But you could read, you could write. It provides you with a chance to be able to read. It means you can pick up the Gazette and you can read it, and you can be aware of the community. You can take it yourself to the next level. You can be aware of the greater community. You can read 140 character tweets and maybe have an idea of what they're about, although you might not. It creates that opening, leveling field. If you have only access to education that is not for everybody, but only for people who could pay for it, then if you couldn't pay for it, you maybe couldn't read, or you couldn't. It creates too many systems. So I think it just is that great evening leveler. And I've seen my kids come up through, and I've seen their peers who have had struggles to read or write get some help, and then after a certain number of times go by, they're all reading, they're all surviving and thriving together. And I see that as that same thing happened. It was available to all of them at their level, and see them come up through it. I see it at the high school level, where access to this has let some kids really thrive and grow and reach something different.
Thank you very much.
Council Klein, and then Committee Member Reed.
Hi. I'm interested in policy questions around responses to what are perceived as behavioral issues, and I'm wondering if you have any experience with things like restorative justice or positive behavior support as a system to respond to classroom issues, group issues, individual behavioral issues. And if you have ideas about kind of alternatives to what have been kind of traditional disciplinary measures.
Thank you. Yes, we have, in the classroom, I have used positive behavior intervention supports, PBIS program in our school. We have that in place. We had it for a couple of years. That works really well for younger kids. It's a little dicey with the older kids. But it was involved. It's a great program because we were catching kids, the way it was told was, catch kids doing good. So it was a way to take the kids who were not your great kids, who might be on that edge or over that edge, and on the days when they are not, you reward them, and you intervene, you give them something good. And it brought some kids back. It definitely makes a difference. Making this intervention, changing this behavior by changing what you're going after, instead of always going after bad dog, go in the corner. It's saying, no, wait, you're doing something good today. Hey, you could do that again tomorrow. Hey, you did it again. You brought your pencil again. You know, it's simple as that. And I think that that's made a big difference. We've used different things at our high school. Instead of using an all-day detention, we've had them doing things in the library with the librarian and working on some project time and doing some research things. So we've had the kids who would have just sat in a room all day with blank white walls because they were late for school for 5 days and skipped a detention or something, they were just in trouble. giving them something to do that gives them a meaning and a reason. You're going to do this little project to work with some people, and it really helped some of those kids think differently about behavior, think differently about the community and the school. So I think there is some sense to that.
Mr. Reed.
I'm going to ask a different question. You mentioned supporting teachers around the shift to the inclusion model, and et cetera. And I'm wondering, you know, there's that challenge for teachers. There's a challenge of trying to institute differentiated instruction that we're working on. And I'm wondering how you specifically on the school committee would go about trying to find new ways to support teachers in these difficult challenges.
New ways to support teachers. Teachers will always want more time for supporting things. As a teacher myself, whenever they are handing us the list of things to do, it's always when, and there's always never. And so that's what you need to start to look at as we look at the school calendar. We need to start to support, are these the days they can get? Is this the hours they will need? Is there release time from duty periods? Is there, you know, you don't have to watch the kids at recess. What the teachers are being made to do that's maybe not academic in nature in the building, is that time when we can use to give them time together? So time is really the thing that the teachers are going to need. They're going to need to sit down with each other, with the papers, with the ideas, and work on that. So that's where we need to think about how to support them best. I don't think they're going to need, you know, more days out in somewhere else going to things to learn about things so much as being around each other in a way that lets them work through some stuff. So I think that that would be the way. I mean, maybe that means some release time. Maybe that means substitute teacher days, things like that, with teams rotating. You have to get creative like that. That would have to be building by building, perhaps. But some things like that is what you would have to would be my suggestion for.
So speaking of time, I'm cognizant of the fact that one of you has to be a school committee member by the stroke of 7.
7:15.
7:15.
Oh, no. So.
Okay. Well, then we got acres of time. are there any other questions? Councilor Murphy.
And I'll ask my same question from earlier. If you're not successful this evening, you consider running for this position in the November election.
Thank you. I think my answer will be very much the same as what we saw before. I think that, you know, I'm here to offer up my services and myself, and to be a part of something that I think works, where what I saw last time was a lot of people that had different opinions but had a unanimous budget and a great discussion, and it's a really working program, and that's very interesting. And if it's working, then great, and I would offer up, hey, you need anything, and sure, I can help. And if that seems to be something not working, then maybe we think about it. But certainly, if it's not broken, that doesn't have to mean that I have to be the one fixing it again.
Any other questions? Mr. Davidson, thank you so much for your candidacy.
Thank you all for your time.
Thank you.
We move on to the next phase, which is the nominations. And I'll accept nominations. It'll require a nomination in a second. Is there anyone interested in making nomination?
I nominate Mr. Davidson to Ward 6 School Committee.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Second. Any other nominations?
Nominate Mr. Hoffman.
Second.
And that second as well. I have to ask this. Are there any other nominations? Accept the motion
to close nominations.
Thank you.
Second.
Okay. All those in favor of closing the nominations, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. The process is a roll call vote, as I said. And as your name is called, please name the candidate that you prefer. And then before we go to this, I have to say once again, thank you both so much. This is actually, you both demonstrated a real problem for us, because this is an unenviable vote, because I think we win regardless. We do all right. But we're very appreciative of the fact and that you people have stepped up, and the quality of your answers and your commitment and understanding of the warp and weave of education as in the challenges that exist here in the community. So thanks. That said, so will the clerk please call the roll? And as I said, when your name is called, Name your candidate, please.
Dennis Bigel.
I get to go first.
Sorry.
With great appreciation for the presentations and the experience of both candidates, Mr. Kaufman.
Mr. Kaufman.
Bill Dwight.
Mr. Davidson.
Elisa Klein.
Mr. Kaufman.
Marianne LaBarge.
Tom Davison.
David Murphy.
Mr. Kaufman.
Jim Nash.
Mr. Kaufman.
Ryan O'Donnell.
Mr. Davidson.
Jillian Shira.
Mr. Kaufman.
Molly Burnham.
Mr. Davidson.
Rebecca Musansky.
Mr. Kaufman.
Laura Fallon.
Mr. Kaufman.
Ann Hennison.
Mr. Davidson.
And Doug Myers.
Mr. Kaufman.
Howard Moore.
Mr. Davidson.
David Narkowitz.
Mr. Davidson.
And Matt Reed.
Mr. Kaufman.
So we have 10 for Mr. Davidson. I mean, 10 for Mr. Kaufman and 7 for Mr. Davidson.
Congratulations, Mr. Kaufman.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Davidson.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate it. Now, the city clerk is here. She's going to give you your robes, your sash, your scepter. and swear you in. So if you'll please step up and... City clerk here is Wendy Kaufman.
That would be a conflict.
What's her name?
Yeah, what's her name?
Thank you.
It's called out of sight, out of mind. What the hell?
Remind me off.
Put your right hand for me. Repeat after me. I, Lonnie Kaufman.
I, Lonnie Kaufman.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
To faithfully and impartially.
To faithfully and impartially.
Discharge the duties.
Discharge the duties.
To the office to which I've been elected.
To the office of which I've been elected.
In accordance with the Constitution of the Commonwealth.
In accordance with the Constitution of the Commonwealth.
The Charter.
The Charter.
Ordinances.
Ordinances.
And the rules of the City of Northampton.
And the rules of the City of Northampton.
To the best of my knowledge and ability.
To the best of my knowledge and ability.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Thank you again. And with that, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Adjourn.
All those in favor of adjourn, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you all.